thing they do for Butte as far as the information they have here. We are so lucky to have the archives, and they can find almost anything you're looking for as far as your past and Butte history and so on and so forth. They help a lot of people who are doing thesis programs, do their research. It's a great place. We're really lucky to have it. So at the end of the day, look in your wallet, and if you have a couple dollars there that want to emigrate to a better place, there's a box out here so you can leave a couple dollars there. Next, I wanted to thank a couple of my cousins from Helena, Vernon Avery and his wife, Vernon Avery O'Leary and his wife Donna. And a few years ago, they put together, they basically spent their retirement researching our family roots, and you can see what they came up with here. Just another tremendous resource for any of us in the family that care to look back and hear the tales. And let's see, I wanted to thank some of my relatives for coming today. My first cousin, Jeannie, here, and her husband,
Jim.
I haven't seen him for a while. Okay. All the way from Avon, yeah. And then my other second cousins over here, Dick, Larry, Kate, Hollow, from the Montana Abstract family. And of course, my wife, Christy, and my son, Russell, over here. He's handling all the technical stuff. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the technical mind.
We wouldn't be here without you either.
That's a fair thing. That's my right. Trying to steal the show. Okay, so I gotta start off by telling you one story, and gotta get the Irish hat on here. So this is a story about a bus driver, and I was just talking to Ruth over here about a bus trip she took in Ireland. But anyway, this was a tour bus in southern Ireland, and it was packed full of tourists, and they're going down one of these old roads in Ireland, and pretty soon the bus driver pulls over and he says, "On this very spot in 1641, the Irish trounced the daylights out of the British, and we sent them packing with their tail between their legs." And so he pulled back on the road, and they went down a little bit further, past a bunch of rock fences and plenty of sheep and some churches and graveyards. And he pulls the bus over on another spot, and there was a castle there. And he said, "In 1643, in this castle, we've surrounded the English. We killed a bunch of them, and then we waited out the rest of them and captured them and took them as prisoners. That we did." And so he gets back in the bus. They all got in the bus, and down the road they went. And they came to a place, a little port in Wexford County called Duncannon. He says, "Ah, yes," he says, "on this very spot in 1645, siege of Duncannon. We captured the city from the British. We sunk their flagship right there in the harbor, and we watched 200 of their sailors drown right before our very eyes. It was a glorious day for Ireland." And about this time, this very indignant Englishman stands up in the aisle of the bus, and he says, "Certainly, sir, certainly, we Englishmen beat you Irish in battle somewhere along this route." And the bus driver says, "Oh, not on my bus they didn't." So the reason I tell that story is because when we Irish talk about our family histories and the history of Ireland, make no mistake, we're driving the bus. So we kind of tell it like we want it to come out. At least 40% of what I say to thee today will be close to the truth. Okay, so we'll start off in County Cork. Let me get the right button here. And our family came from a place called Mill Street. It was a farm, ranch, whatever, close to Mill Street, which is about 40 miles, 50 miles from the city of Cork. And what they had there was basically a racehorse farm. They raised racehorses, and the name of the family area was called Knocknagina, Knocknagia. And it was rather large, and and they had a lot of racehorses back in the day. We went there in 2005 on a family trip, and we had other relatives had gone there before, and so we had the directions on how to get to Nakavia. And so we went up and knocked on the door, and these were the people that were living there then. And by coincidence, their name was O'Leary. They weren't related to us. But typical of the rural Irish, they were very hospitable. They invited us in. The fellow there dropped what he was doing. He was out milking cows. And he dropped what he was doing, came in, and they fed us biscuits and tea, and we had a very nice visit about the area. And then they got us along our way, pointed us toward a bed and breakfast or some place to stay. Oops. Okay, so my great-great-grandfather, his name was Cornelius O'Leary. He was born about 1800. We don't know exactly when he was born. And he married a woman by the name of Mary Williams in 1822. We're not quite sure how they came about having Nakavia. This belief is that they were fairly well off, and so he may have inherited this place from other relatives. But anyway, they had the racehorse farm there, and immediately, of course, Cornelius and Mary started having kids. So in 1823, they had a son, which was Cornelius Jr., and they had a daughter in 1824. They had twins in 1825, another daughter in 1827, another daughter in 1831. And then in 1832, on the 29th of September, was born another son by the name of John Charles. And he's my namesake. And I have to say, he had a very adventurous life. And so he's my favorite of all the relatives. I wish that I could have ghosted along with him for his entire life, because he has a very interesting life. But he might have been kind of a difficult son, because they waited five more years before they had any more. They had another son in 1837 and another one in 1838. Now, these were the racehorse barns in Nakavia. So I found this picture the other day and stole it off the internet. I give credit to the Rance Jones there, who's painted this watercolor. This is kind of what I imagined it might have looked like around Nakavia when John Charles was a little boy. And between his birth year, 1832, and let's say up until he was about 13, I can only imagine what kind of an idyllic life he had there, with all this property and all the horses that he wanted to ride. They probably had great gardens. He had four brothers and four sisters to play with. And it just had to be a really good life. I can just imagine him, you know, riding around with his friends, playing cowboys and Indians, or whipping. It would be the Irish and the English. And I can see John Charles saying, okay, I'm the Irish guy, and all the rest of you are English, and you're all going to die today, and it'll be a glorious day for Ireland. I'm sure he had a wonderful time as a youth there, and I relate to that because it was very similar to my youth, and we had a pile of horses out at the Staghorn Ranch, and I had my choice of pretty much any of the horses. This particular horse here is called Toby, and I'll tell you a story later of how I came about riding Toby. He was the first fast horse that I ever owned. So, here we are in County Cork, rural Ireland. That's another painting I stole off the internet. And so life had to be really great up until about 1845, and that is when the potato blight this is not a blighted potato, this is the healthy potato. But I needed a prop, so somebody asked me, are you going to pass it around? And no, somebody might eat it. So the blight started, it had already started in Europe, in various countries in Europe. There was different crop failures. But in the west of Ireland, the blight really kind of started taking off in about 1845. And, you know, we can think that, all these Irishmen came to America because of a potato blight. But there was a lot of other factors that played into the famine at this time period. And we could spend hours just talking about the famine and the flight to America, but I'm just going to touch on a few of the high points that I think were significant at that time. There was a Prime Minister of England at the time, was Sir Robert Peel, and he actually was somewhat sympathetic toward the Irish famine problem and had arranged for shipments of grain. A lot of corn came from America and to help these people survive. But Mr. Peel was defeated in an election in 1846 by Lord John Russell, and that was the Whig party, I guess. And so he left, and that was to the detriment of the Irish people. And the people who suffered the most were the what they call the subsistence class. In Ireland, most of the land, especially all the good land, was owned by English lords. And the Irish were simply tenants. And they had to work and grow crops, and then they had to pay the landlords a bunch of their money and part of their crop just for the privilege of living there. And then there was a lot of the really poor Irish that just had these little tiny plots that had been divided and subdivided and subdivided over the years. And the only thing that they could grow to sustain their lives on was potatoes. And you had sort of a monoculture of potatoes, and they all grew the same thing. So when the blight hit, it hit them hard. But when Lord Russell took over, he appointed this fellow here, Charles Trevelyan, to be in charge. He was the chief administrator of relief for the Irish peasants. And really, his actions and his sentiments toward the Irish has been referred to as quasi-genocidal. He really didn't like the Irish at all. There was even people in the British government at the time that believed that God was punishing the Irish. Not sure what for. I guess it was all those whoopings they took back in the day. But the Irish needed to be punished. And they also believed that it was a mechanism for removing excess population. And it did. It killed over 1 million Irishmen. To compound all this, the winter of 1846 and 1847 was just horrendous. It buried some of the homes in snow. Typically, they never got much snow in Ireland, but people were just buried in snow. There was ongoing starvation and panic among the Irish. There was some a thing called the Irish Board of Work that tried to create makeshift jobs for these people, but the inflation was so bad they couldn't buy anything anyway. Trevelyan here and Lord Russell, they canceled the corn shipments from America. They said Irish poverty needs to be solved by Irish property, is their belief. As the famine progressed, there was rampant fever, black fever, dysentery, something called famine dropsy, and just out and out starvation. I wanted to read you one account here, if I can find it. Oh, yes. There was a Nicholas Cummins, who was the magistrate of Cork, visited the hard-hit coastal district of Skibbereen. Skibbereen is in the west of County Cork. I entered some of the hovels he wrote, and the scenes which presented themselves were such that no tongue or pen... some of this chokes me up. I'm Irish. And the scenes that presented themselves were such that no tongue or pen can convey the slightest idea of. In the first, six famished and ghastly skeletons, to all appearances dead, were huddled in the corner on some filthy straw, their soul covering what seemed a ragged horse cloth, their wretched legs hanging about, naked above the knees. I approached with horror and found by a low moaning that they were alive. They were in fever, four children, a woman, and what had once been a man. It is impossible to go through the detail. Suffice it to say that in a few minutes I was surrounded by at least 200 such phantoms, such frightful specters as no words can describe, suffering from famine or from fever. Their demonic yells are still ringing in my ears, and their horrible images are fixed upon my brain. There's a poem out there you can read on the internet called Skibbereen, which you can look that up. But here's one verse. Sinead O'Connor, who's a singer, sang her own version of Skibbereen. And it's, "Oh, well, I do remember that late December day, the landlord and the sheriff came to drive us all away. They set my roof on fire with their cursed English spleen, and that's another reason why I left old Skibbereen." So what that refers to is the landlords didn't want to be responsible for the peasant Irish, and they simply forced them out of their homes, off the land, and these people were wandering around Ireland begging. They had tremendous the dysentery and the fevers. They even called one road fever, because people would simply lay down on the side of the road and die. So it was horrendous times. Now, you can say, well, why worry about that? It's 170 years ago. It's history. Can't be undone. Why worry? And that's a good question. For me, you know, besides the fact that I don't mind having a Guinness stout and listening to some sad Kathy Ryan music and shedding a tear for the Irish at that time, just aside from that, there are some real parallels with the world today. Do we know any people in this world who are fleeing their homeland to find a better place to live? Have we heard any stories about people crossing water in boats and drowning with their children? Are there any places in the world that are experiencing genocide? The other thing I failed to mention before is that the food distribution in Ireland was almost non-existent. To try to get food from one area to another, there was no real roads, no railroads to speak of. And in the world today, there is a real problem with equitable food distribution. And finally, ponder, if you will, the politics and the policies of hate that we can watch every day at 5 o'clock, on the 5 o'clock news. So there's some real parallels. Anyway. All right, so that's my political statement for today. You know I had to make one, didn't you?
I knew you had to. Okay. I missed you, Charlie.
Okay, so let's see. We're going to move on here if I can find the right piece of paper. Let's see, advance the slide. Okay, there's... Oh, and I wanted to mention that if you're a student of the famine, this is a book I came across a while back. It's called The Famine Ships. And it's more having to do with the flight to America and the hardships that the Irish endured on their way on some of these famine ships. It was just horrendous. Okay, so move on here. Here's how I imagine the conversation went one night about in 1949 at Knockmaghia, when Mary and Cornelius called the family in, all the 9 kids, and they had dinner. They had some mutton and some cabbage and some tea. After dinner, Cornelius said, "Well, kids, things haven't been going too well here in Ireland the last few years, and we're not really sure how well we're going to make it. We've eaten most of the sheep. There's nothing in the horse market for racehorses right now. Things are pretty tough. So here's what's going to happen. Your oldest brother, Cornelius Jr., he gets Knockmaghia. And the rest of you get to go out in the world and seek your fortunes. Like the 3 little piggies. Except there's 8 of you. And you get to go." So young John Charles, he went to bed that night and he thought about it. And he was only 16. But he thought, "I'm not sticking around any longer to see if this gets better or gets worse." So later that year, he went to America. His family, they probably saddled up some horses and rode down to the Cove of Cork. He got on a boat and he sailed to New York. Never to see his parents again. So when he landed in New York, he was 16 years and 11 months. And I can't even imagine what that was like to be alone in New York at that age. I don't know how long he stayed there, but it wasn't too long before he headed out and moved to Flint, Michigan. Heard they had good water there. I didn't think that would be the So he went to Flint, Michigan and became a lumberjack. And this was an up-and-coming thing around there at that time. Didn't stay a lumberjack very long. Let's see, I've got to start moving along with the pictures. Pretty soon he became a boss, and soon after that he was running his own lumber company. And in 1858, there was a very successful businessman and highly respected horticulturist by the name of Henry Crapo, moved from Massachusetts to Michigan to manage his timberland investments. John Charles went to work for Crapo and eventually managed a large lumber plant in Flint. In the meantime, Crapo was the mayor of Flint, became a state senator, and eventually the governor of Michigan. That was in 1964. One of the things I wondered about is, you know, a lot of the Irish got volunteered or got drafted into the Union armies in the Civil War, both armies. And I wondered, how did John Charles escape having to go to the Civil War? And the answer, I guess, was that he, you know, was in the right place at the right time. There was huge demand for lumber in the Civil War. And this Crapo guy was involved in railroading. They built some railroads into Flint. And so they were going gangbusters in the timber business. He could have joined a pretty famous general who was in charge of the Michigan Wolverines, a guy by the name of George Armstrong Custer. He could have gone with him and been famous. Mm-hmm. And got to Montana a little earlier. Checked out for him. So, the rest of the siblings in Ireland, between 1850 and 1856, all emigrated to America, except for the oldest one that stayed at Knockmaghia. And so they all followed young John Charles to Flint, Michigan, and they all settled around there in Flint and Lapeer County. In December of 1865, John Charles, this is right after the Civil War ends, he married Alice Marie Vernon, solid Irish girl. She had one parent was from Belfast, the other was from Baltimore County Cork. He was 33 and she was 21. Cradle Rodney? Okay, and her name again was Alice Marie Vernon. And that name Vernon permeates all of our family history. We have so many relatives who have the name Vernon, whether it's Vernon Avery or Mabel Vernon, John Vernon, that name really hung on. So 10 months later, okay, so they got married. He was 33, she's 21. 10 months later, in 1866, my grandfather, John Vernon O'Leary, was born in Flint. 1870, there was another son, Albert Patrick, who was born in Flint. And I'll tell you a little bit about him. He went to medical school at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor in the 1890s. And he was roommates with a law student there, a guy by the name of Cornelius F. Kelly. Ring a bell to anybody? Con Kelly, who later became the president of the ACM in Butte from 1918 to 1940. We'll get back to that relationship here in a little bit. So AP, after he got his doctor's degree, he moved off to Big Timber, where he was both a doctor there and the mayor. He elected mayor three times at Big Timber. So John Charles, then they had two more children, both boys that died at five and three. One of those was named Charles. In 1876, daughter Molly Vernon, she was born in Flint, wound up moving to Butte. In 1900, she opened an art studio. She was an artist, opened an art studio, taught art at the Monroe and the Lincoln Schools. She was an acclaimed artist herself, and she helped get a branch of the Montana Institute of the Arts started here in Butte. And in 1909, she married, here's a mouthful, Professor Aaron Alonzo Franklin Rice, a guy by the name A.F. Rice, and he was the founder of the Butte Business College. Did that ring a bell with anybody here, Butte mm-hmm. Business College? Mm-hmm. So in around 1873-74, there was a financial panic back east, which began a gradual decline in Michigan, in the Michigan timber industry. Many of the mills were closing. And so John Charles, again, he's not going to wait around and see if things get better or worse. So he and his wife, Alice, moved west, and the quote was, to grow up with the country. They lived in the Dalles, Oregon, where they bought a bunch of land and 1,600 sheep. They had two more children there. This was his start as a stockman. And he was all over. He was in Oregon, he was in Idaho, he was in all over in Montana with his various land holdings and stock venture, stockman ventures, mostly sheep. And he was in partnership with several of his children. My grandfather, then John Vernon, he got into the sheep business. And they did this all the way up until 1914. And in all that time, he was only shot in the leg one time. In 1914, he delivered 3,000 sheep to the Union stockyards in Chicago. How do you do that? How do you take 3,000 sheep and ship them to Chicago? Just imagine how long that train was. And he was, now he's 82. He takes 3,000 sheep to Chicago. And he was interviewed by the Chicago Daily at that time. He's quoted as saying, there's the end of 37 years on the range. 37 years as a sheep man. And he was described in the article this way. John O'Leary, pioneer stockman of the Pacific Coast, is 80, looks 60, acts 40, feels 20. This is why I like this guy. So he had a wonderful life, John Charles did. He died 6 years later in Big Timber. He's buried over in Big Timber with a whole lot of our relatives. Okay, so now we'll move on to the next generation. This is John Vernon O'Leary. He was born in 1866, moved to Oregon in 77, and he marries Mary Henderson Wright in 1888. They were doing sheep ranching around the Dalles, which is on the river there, in a place called Grass Valley, which is more over on the drier part of Oregon, all around Mount Hood. And they used to take the sheep up on Mount Hood in the summertime. Am I behind in my slides? I bet I am. Good talking here. Yeah, there's John Vernon. Okay. And that's, I think, that's the only picture I've seen of him. I don't know about the rest of the relatives. I'd love to get another picture of John Vernon. What the next one is. Okay, we'll go back to that one. So they were sheep ranching around Mount Hood for 15 years. They had 11 children. All of these guys, they just wanted to have so many kids. Beginning in 1889 to 1910, the first one was your grandpa, Ralph Sheridan O'Leary. He was born in the Dalles. Six were born in the Dalles and Grass Valley, but the family moved to Mackenzie Bridge after John Vernon sold his sheep one time and got into a card game. And he lost all the money in the card game. So, and I don't know how they managed to lose all the money and then still go start up somewhere else, but maybe John Charles was helping them out there a little bit. So they went to Mackenzie Bridge, and they had a grocery store there and a feed stable. It was sort of a waypoint between other areas. And then they started doing a little sheep ranching down toward the Willamette Valley around Eugene and Pleasant Hill. In 1908, the official population of Mackenzie Bridge was 15. 11 of them were O'Leary's. Okay, so in the meantime, John Vernon's sisters, Edith and Molly, were both here in Butte. They were teaching, and they were running a boarding house, and doing all kinds of stuff. And they must have been talking back and forth. A lot of the family had wound up in Montana at that time, Helena and Big Timber area. So they convinced John Vernon to bring his teams. He had teams of horses. Bring those to Butte. The mines are looking for teams and workers with teams. So they get to Butte. Oh, boy, I skipped something. So three of the kids that they had were born in Mackenzie Bridge. And that's the tallest one there is Kenneth. And the one that looks like a girl is my Uncle Chink, Uncle Harold. And the one in the baby buggy there is my dad, Dean O'Leary. And that's the only baby picture we have of him. So they were born, and Uncle Chink used to tell me about the Indians coming through dragging travois past the little grocery store they had there back in the early 1900s. So they moved to Butte, and I'm sure that Molly didn't tell them about all the strife that was going on in Butte in 1914 when the Miners' Union Hall was blown up and all the troubles between the union and the company. But they made it here, and unfortunately the teams were pretty much worthless because trucks were coming into play at the time, and there was no teamster work for guys with teams, something else. But John Vernon and I think possibly Ralph and possibly Searle all went to work in the mines. And John Vernon immediately got real involved in the unions, and probably the IWW. And so they would, they got here in 1917. That's the same year as the Speculator Mine Fire and the same year that Frank Little was hung off the Centennial Street Bridge. So there was just a lot of strife going on. And John Vernon gets real involved in the unions. And so, of course, they get blackballed. And you had to have a rustling card. The company had instituted this rustling card system. If you didn't have a wrestling card, you weren't going to get on at the mines. And so they got blackballed several times over the next few years. And at one point, they just all packed up and went down to Thermopolis, Wyoming and started farming again. Message came through that the blackball had been dropped. And this is the connection back to Doc O'Leary and Big Timber and Con Kelly. They had room together at Ann Arbor. And Doc O'Leary intervened, called up his old roommate and said, "Hey, you know, can you cut my brother a little slack here and let him go back to work?" So sure enough, that's what happened. The blackball had been dropped. They threw down their shovels in Thermopolis, Wyoming, and came back to Butte just as quick as they could. And John Vernon worked the rest of his life, another 14 years, I think, underground in Butte and being involved in the unions. Somebody said, well, they don't know what he liked the most. Was it being underground digging ore, or was it fighting with the company? It was one or the other. So So my dad had been was born in Kinsey Bridge in 1907, and so he came to Butte when he was 10 years old. And they were back and forth, you know, in different places, but he wound up going to Butte High School, and that's the Butte High team there in 1925-26. I don't know if any of these names, somebody might, starting, let's see, I got a pointer. This is Persh Nance, and then in the middle there, Chuck Davis. Anybody remember that name? Yeah.
He was the superintendent
of schools in Butte. The next guy is Jack Davis, then Lacey McDougall, my dad in the middle, right here with the basketball, and Doc Kyle. My dad and his brothers, they loved to fish. And so they would go around in the summertime and they would say, they'd go around to all these little stores and markets around Butte and they'd say, "Gee, sir, we're collecting for the Dublin Gulch Athletic Club annual summer picnic. Would you care to donate?" And so pretty soon they'd have ham and they'd have some a loaf of bread and some apples and they'd head down to the Silver Bow, jump the train, ride down to Glen, and they would have the Dublin Gulch annual picnic. Oh, got to back up and tell one more story here. So anyway, he graduated from high school, and he and a bunch of his buddies decided to go to the University of Montana. And they get over there, and they're doing okay. It might have been about their second year. They were taking chemistry class. And this is right during Prohibition. Not that they were old enough, I don't know what the drinking age was, but it's during Prohibition. And they developed this little chemistry project there. And I guess it was when the fire happened that they got discovered. But they were all encouraged to maybe come back to the university later on when they were a little more serious about getting an education. So this happened, you know, kind of in the winter. And they couldn't come back to Butte and tell their parents they'd been booted out of the college and out of the dorm. So a bunch of them went up into the rattlesnake area around Missoula. They found an old deserted cabin of some sort, moved into that, cleaned it out. They had a roof over their heads. And then my dad told me that they poached several deer, and they would, you know, every so often they'd poach a deer, and they would take the meat into town and trade it for vegetables and whatever else they needed. That's how they survived. To get a little spending money, there was a bar downtown in Missoula somewhere that had a boxing ring. And people could volunteer to get up there and box. And if you put on a good show, people would throw nickels up on the mat. And so he and his buddy, they were scamming here. They got up there, and it was sort of like Chicago wrestling, you know, it wasn't really real. But they would bite their own lips and get some blood going, and they'd be spitting blood out on the mat to make a better show of it all. And so then at the end of the fight, they had sore lips, but they also had a lot of nickels. So that's how they survived. And then they came home the next spring and must have said to their parents, "Well, college, that just isn't for us right now." So this was my dad's first wife, Natalie. Married her in 1928. And my daughter Pat, or my sister Pat, I'm sorry, was born the next year, 2 months after the stock market crash, 1929. And if anybody is around 84 now, I don't know if you remember her, she was a head majorette for Butte High, and she got to perform in the Rose Bowl parade. But also then, she later on, she was at Pearl Harbor on Oahu when it was bombed. Natalie Livermore here, she was later in life, in my dad's life, referred to as number one. Okay, so in 1930, John Vernon dies. And he worked right until the day he died, right over Nanny Goat Hill here at the West Calusa Mine. That's where he was working. He was sick 2 days and passed away. So here's the picture of all the 10 kids. There was 11. Kenneth had died. I think I mentioned that when he was 6. Maybe I didn't. There was 10 of them. And 5 of them here. This is Aunt Mabel. She was the principal of the Harrison and the Grant School. that's your grandpa's name. Yeah, Ralph. Uncle Chink ran some gas stations and so forth. Aunt Genevieve, wonderful lady, was also a teacher. And my dad. So these five settled in Butte. Some of the others were settled in Helena. This is your dad, Weege. Leland. They all had nicknames. You know, Uncle Bob, they called him Mope. I mean, he's one of the smartest of the bunch, don't you think? Yeah, I don't know why they called him Mope. This was Red. My dad was Carrot. Harold was named Chink. I have no idea why he got that. And Stubb up here, he's the one who went to California. This kind of got the Elvis look going, but 20 years ahead of when Elvis was born. But anyway, he was one. Well, this was the greatest bunch of uncles and aunts that a person could ever want to have. You know, and there's not many big families like that anymore, but these were just wonderful people to be around as a kid.
Who's the boy in the window?
Well, yeah, that's a photo bomber. Yeah. I was trying to figure that out this morning, and I thought maybe it was your grandpa, or Dick, your dad. But he wasn't born until 32. So, that looks like a boy, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it couldn't have been one of the granddaughters. Who knows? But yeah, photobombing, it was there. let's see. Lost my train of thought for a minute. Oh, there was a lot of cousins. There's about 30 first cousins. And I was the last one to come along. And it's starting to dwindle down quite a bit now. We've lost quite a few of the first cousins. But what a great bunch. So now we got the Depression, and my dad has got a wife and a daughter and a widowed mother, and times were really tough. He sold candy for Society. Uncle Red was the salesman for Society Candy, and I think he got my dad on in eastern Montana. And my dad, it was a sweet job. But he always talked about the gumbo in eastern Montana that was just, you know, you were stuck all the time. There was no paved roads. He had a Model T and he was just stuck all the time. And then my dad also worked for Uncle Chink in the tire business. They were always doing something with automobiles or tires. And he managed to get through. But at one point he found himself just out of work, and he could not get a job in the mines. And things were kind of tough during the Depression there. So he hatched this plan. The superintendent of the mines in Butte at the time was Edward Renoir. And he actually lived up at the Mountain Con mine. And that's where his office was and his home was. And so my dad thought he was going to get a little creative here. He borrowed a Packard automobile from somebody and cleaned it all up. Put on his best suit, probably the one he's wearing there, or his only suit, slicked his hair back, took a big envelope and stuffed it full of newspapers, so it was real thick, gets in the Packard, he goes bombing up to the gate. Now apparently there was a gate with a guard. He goes bombing up to the gate, blowing the horn, got the window down, he's waving this package. He says, "Urgent message for Renoir, urgent message for Renoir." So the guard let him through. He goes in, he uses the same ploy to get past the secretary, gets into Renoir's office, and Renoir says, "Oh, I understand you have an urgent message." And he says, "Yeah, that's right. I need a damn job." So Renoir apparently saw appreciated the cleverness of the ploy, and he said, "You start tomorrow morning at the Mountain Con." So my dad mined for quite a few years. Let's see what we got next. And we'll go back. But he knew that mining, it wasn't something he wanted to do. And I think when he quit the Butte mines, probably sometime in the early 40s, 42, somewhere in there, that was probably the end of any of the old areas mining. I don't think anybody else was involved in it. But the thing that's in our blood is the being on the land, having a lot of animals around, whether it's sheep or chickens or horses or cows or whatever. One time I was up at my cousin Dean's place in west of Helena at a family reunion, And Cousin Dean had all these chickens, just tons of chickens around. I said, geez, Cousin Dean, why do you have all these chickens? And he said, why do you have all them dang horses? We had a pile of horses at the time. But, and Cousin Danny, you know, he was in the racehorse business in Helena for a while, and he had all these racehorses. And you know how you become a millionaire in the racehorse business, don't you? You start off with $2 million. So it's kind of in our blood to be on the land and have a lot of different animals. So anyway, where was I going with that? So my dad quit the vines. He started buying the land out of Beef Trail, which became the Staghorn Ranch. Okay. Oh, here it is. Okay, I'll have to go back to those. So in 1945, this is my Uncle Bob, and he had just gotten out of the Navy. And he and my dad were quite close, and they loved being in the mountains, and they spent many an hour up there, many a day up in the Bob Marshall. And they were both kind of very interested in the dude ranch business. And this was a letter, and cousin Danny sent me this letter. He found this letter in his parents' things after they were both deceased. And it was a letter from my dad to his dad. It's February of 1946, just shortly before he married my mother. And in this letter, they're scheming about this grand dude ranch plan and so forth. And my dad had some reservations about it, and he goes through what he thinks are necessary. But toward the bottom, he says, he's talking about the Staghorn Ranch, and he's met this woman, my mother, and he says, my little woman is very much in love with the Staghorn Ranch. It's set on a new or remodeled house, a good barn, a small greenhouse that she claims will grow her $1,000 worth of flowers. She was a florist. He wants 20 new saddles and that many more horses, 12 milk cows, 12 white-faced cows. And he says, when I get all that, have it paid for, my back-breaking days are over. I figure 3 years to get it done. Believe me, it was more like 23 years. And he got a lot of this stuff that he was, you got to admire the guy. He was 39, I think, at the time. He had all these hopes and dreams. He had a woman that he felt he was going to make it with. In the meantime, he had number two, and then he married number one again, and number three. And so my mother became number four. But anyway, I really cherish this letter because nobody writes letters anymore. Emails, and they all get lost and deleted. But believe me, this letter, it gives me a real glimpse into what was going on in my dad's mind back in the day. So, let's see, I'll go back here. So this is my mother, and they met. She came up from upstream from Missoula. They met and got married in 1946. And she was worked for years for Agajean Galubin down here at Galubin's Flowers. That was a great career for her. So they got married. They're out of the Staghorn. My dad did buy another piece of property to add on. He got the saddles and the horses and all that business. And he was in the outfitting business. My brother came along in 1948. I don't know if any of you knew him from Montana Tech. Yeah? Oh, yeah, he used to work with Jimmy. And then I came along in 1951. And you can see my parents had high expectations on me right off the bat. They got me this class of 69 shirt here when I'm just a baby. And my dad, of course, was set on turning us into hunters. And he was enjoying the heck out of that. You'll notice here that my brother and I, our hair is, you know, really slicked back, and she would always dress us up for these pictures. And so here we are, a picture in the garden, and you can see all our hair is combed. And what she used to do is she would take egg whites and apparently mix it with water or something, and she would comb it into our hair. You know, it was like a hard hat. We'd be standing there in a 40-mile-an-hour wind, there wouldn't be a hair out of place. You know? But she got some good pictures of us, taught us how to garden. Okay, I'm going to move along here. So, here I am, getting ready to do battle with the chickens. That road right there, my dad built that with a horse-drawn Fresno. You know what a Fresno is? A big scoop. And he drug all that dirt down and built that dam. It stands still there today. So yeah, here we are, another dress-up picture. My mom must have thought we were twins and I was the stunted one. Whatever my brother got, I got. We had great times on the ranch growing up. It was just all kinds of interesting adventures. This is kind of a watershed day in my life. My dad took me on my very first pack trip up into the Anaconda Pintler. Really, it changed my life. It made me fall in love with the backcountry and wilderness. Caught a pile of fish. So here we are back to Toby, my first fast horse. When I was younger, I was kind of relegated to the slower mares, and we had to wrangle horses. We had so many horses. We had like 50, 60, 70 horses. We didn't have enough room on the ranch to feed them all, so they were all out on open range, everywhere from where Victor Chemical used to be all the way around to the Safeway warehouse. And about this time of year, we would start renting out horses again on the weekends. So a Friday after school, our job was to wrangle in all of these horses. My dad would start one of us off on the east side of town, one on the west side of town, and we'd have to push all these horses in. It just took hours. And so one time, I was riding this old slow buckskin mare named Bucky, and after all of this riding, I unsaddled Bucky, and she was all sweaty and lathery, and I wanted to clean her up. And so I started grooming her with the grooming tools, and my curry comb just kind of kept hanging up on her back. And I thought, what the heck's going on here? And I get looking, and she was just loaded with ticks, engorged ticks. And I thought, oh, my poor horse, I've got to do something about this. So I had heard the old cowboys talking about being able to put some kind of like oil or Vaseline or something on a tick, and they couldn't breathe, and they would back out. So anyway, I go in the barn, and I find this bucket of motor oil, crane oil, just to soak fence posts in. And I smear it all over Bucky's back, and I'm watching these ticks, and nothing's happening. Being an impatient 10-year-old, I thought, well, wait a minute, there was another thing I used to hear the cowboys talk about. and that was you touch something hot to the ticks, and they didn't like that, and they'd squirm and back up. So I go in the house, and I arm myself with a handful of stick matches, and I come out, and I strike one on my zipper, and I touch it to one of the ticks. Pretty soon, the oil starts on fire, and I jump back, and their whole back is in flames. And so there was a snowbank not too far away, and I start throwing snow at her, and she's pulling back, and her eyes are getting big. And finally, I found this old piece of wet tarp in the back of an old Jeep, and I start slapping her on the back with this tarp. It was really scary for both of us. And about that time, my brother came along and witnessed this. He ran right in the house. Dad, Chuck's lit his horse on fire. And I didn't really get in any trouble for that, but my parents at one point had suggested I should grow up and become a veterinarian. They didn't do that anymore. So Bucky became really hard to catch after that. I don't know why. anyway, then I graduated to Toby, and he was just a really fast horse, great for wrangling. Okay, so that's there's a shot of all the horses. One was on strike there. And we used to rent horses out for like $3 a day. People would take them into Butte, ride all over for $3 a day. We used to do these rides for the YMCA kids. One of the other fun things we used to do was in branding. We'd have like 15 new colts each year, and we'd brand them in the fall. And so we'd get them all the colts in one corral, and we'd run them around and hang a lariat on the side. A colt would jump through it, and we'd pull it, and they'd tip over. And our job was to jump on their heads, and you grab an ear, and you cover their eye like this, and keep them down. They can't get their head up, they can't get up. And then my dad would come over and do the brand. And then whoever wasn't holding the head got to get on the colt. And when you let them go, and they'd get up, and they'd buck all over the place, and we'd get pitched off. That was great fun. Get pitched off 7 times in a couple hours. So my dad got into the outfitting business big time. He had actually 2 different businesses, Staghorn Ranch and Big Hole Lodge in Wise River. And he used to send out these promotional cards to prospective clients. He wanted, got to have some game in the picture. So he'd go down to Jack Atchison's taxidermy shop, and they would stage these pictures. He put something like the 1961 trophies. And we packed a lot of elk on the horses there. So that's you know, we've gone through a lot of generations there, from back in Ireland, all the way from East Coast to West Coast, and again, we all like the land, we like the mountains, we like raising animals. The next generation, my son over here, where he's the great-great-great-grandson of Cornelius O'Leary, and it'll be up to him to carry on the family traditions. So with that, we'll call it good. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to...